our meeting. If we'd please have the roll call by the town clerk.
Chairman Cogswell?
Here.
Counselor Amaro?
Here.
Counselor Creelman?
Here.
Counselor Jordan?
Yeah.
Counselor McLaughlin?
Here.
Counselor Pearson?
Here.
Counselor Reed?
Here. The minutes of our last meeting, number 6, 1990-91, which was held on September 10th, 1990. Are there any corrections or additions? I do have one that I want to put forth. It's under item number 75, which is on the second page. It was the motion dealing with the council's acceptance of the Greystone Road, Granite Ridge Road, Dyer Pond. And I believe we conditioned it that we would not review it again until all the councils had received as-built drawings, and then we would reconsider its acceptance. Does that sound? So I have the amendment here to give to the clerk. So if there are any other corrections or additions? If not, I'll take a motion on the minutes.
Madam Chairman, I'll move that the minutes be accepted as amended.
So, second?
All in favor? Next item on the agenda, Cape Elizabeth Citizens Discussion of Items Not on the Agenda. Is there anyone who wishes to come forward to make a statement?
Good evening. My name is Tim Thompson, and I'm a resident of Cape Elizabeth at 6 Pine Ridge Road. I think all the members of the council have received a copy of the memorandum that I'd like to go over tonight. Has everybody received a copy of the memorandum from the concerned residents and taxpayers?
Yes.
Okay. What we wanted to do tonight is just bring the town council up to date on where we are with our group. The CR&T group now is numbering 100, and we got together regarding the interest around and continuing growing interest around Dr. Pelletier's severance and retirement agreement. We did want to bring the town council up to date in the matters that we have retained an attorney for the purposes of reviewing his agreement. And the review, although it's preliminary at this point, indicates that an injunction would be a legitimate legal action and would not, certainly is not intended to be a nuisance action. This action is being taken in the best interest of the town and its taxpayers, and we're not going to try this in the newspapers and bring any further embarrassment to the town. Our attorney is looking into the options and alternatives that we have regarding challenging the agreement, and he feels that numerous legal avenues do exist. I did want to let you know that Tom Skypeck and myself are the facilitators for the group, and I've indicated both Tom's address as 14 Fenway Road, Cape Elizabeth, his telephone number 767-5549, and my own address, 6 Pine Ridge Road, Cape Elizabeth, 799-6669. We felt that it was important that we did update the town council, as we've had an opportunity to input at the workshop that you held on this matter, and there were several members from the town council that came to our meeting with regard to this item. Just to cover a couple of additional items, and I am counseled not to get into too many specifics at this point because of the legal environment that exists and the area of concern that we have with regard to Dr. Pelletier's agreement to cover his legal fees in defending our actions. However, we did feel it was necessary to take the action we are taking. We asked the town to do something similar to that, and their counsel advised them that they really didn't have a legitimate avenue to take to challenge that agreement. We feel that there is a growing concern of our taxpayers in this town. if you had an opportunity to view the school board meeting last night, which I had intended on participating in and letting them, bringing them up to date on our actions, but towards the end of that meeting, it got a little bit emotional, and I didn't want to get involved in that. But I'm sure this will serve to update them as to the fact that there is, in fact, a group that's been organized and that legal action is being taken against this agreement. There is a strong feeling in this town, as I think is most evidenced by the fact that as tax bills are coming in, I spoke earlier with our town manager, and he indicated that one out of three tax bills that's being sent in to this town, there are comments being made about this agreement, the money being spent on this agreement, and the money that's been spent in the construction, reconstruction, deconstruction, and proposed reconstruction on the school projects. The school board would have you feel, and spoke publicly last night at their meeting, that they've received no negative feedback with regard to that. Well, I would say the best evidence that you have as a town council is that one in three of your tax bills that are coming in with comments with regard to this. I guess I would ask the town manager if that is a fair...
Yes, it is.
Okay. I think this is something that's serious. I think one of the comments that was made by the school board last night is that they felt it was the least expensive way to handle this problem. I guess what we're going to try to do is accomplish what is right. Maybe what is right might cost us a little bit more money, but I think it's an example we have to set for our citizenry, our children, to back up the courage that they displayed early on in this process of standing up for their rights and getting what they needed in their education system. And I'd answer any questions that any of the town council might have. Thank you for your time.
Any comments from councilors? I would just like to say, Mr. Thompson, that I hope that with this whole experience that we've had, that such energy can also be channeled constructively, and that we can have learned from the mistakes that we've discovered, and that we can look forward and not continue to look backwards in this situation. We're not going to have a debate tonight.
No, of course not. And I fully agree with you, and I think that is, we may not be able to change this agreement. The courts will decide that. But what we certainly would like to have as an outcome of this is some way of, in the future, when something like this arises, hopefully, God forbid, it never will again, but if it does, we'd like to have some way of impacting on how these decisions are made, how a school board can spend unallocated funds. What if this was $500,000 that they spent, or $1 million that they spent? My understanding of the way it works today, they could do that, and the town council couldn't do anything about it. We as taxpayers couldn't do anything about it. And there's something that's got, maybe there's something that can be put in place, and as you say, Phyllis, that can come out of this that's positive. We certainly want to be positive. We want to be forward-thinking, but we also want to do what's right. Thank you.
Any other citizens who wish to make a comment? If not, I'll close this part of the agenda. Reports and correspondence.
Madam Chairman, you have...
Councilor Reed.
I'm sorry. You have before you a report. I was lucky enough to attend on September 29th, 1990, the installation and homecoming of Mrs. Frances Booth as National President of the Ladies Auxiliary of the Veterans of Foreign War of the United States. And I would like to show you that she has given to over 500 people in attendance at that meeting from all over the country the replica of the Portland Headlight. It was very well attended with elected officials and guests, and Mrs. Booth has really honored Cape Elizabeth by her receipt of this very high office. Thank you.
Thank you. Council McLaughlin.
Madam Chairman, I attended the COG Executive Committee held in September. I think one of the most important things for Cape Elizabeth that was discussed that evening was the training workshops that COG does sponsor and the possibility of bringing those workshops to the town rather than having townsfolk interested in them travel into a central location such as Portland. And I think that's something we can look into that I will discuss further with the manager probably. They do have a number of workshops going on this fall that I want to bring to the attention of the rest of the council. Two coming up, well, there are three coming up this month under local planning and development. They're on Thursday evenings, I believe, one on legislative initiatives, one on community design, where inventory meets implementation, and the last one on November 15th on local traffic and transportation issues. So if people are interested in those and you've lost your flyer, this was a gray one, they're using colored paper now, so it's easier to find in your piles. Give me a call and I can give you more information on it. Another event that I was fortunate to participate in was going to the Cape High School ninth grade civics classes. I know we have some of those students in attendance tonight. This is something I did last spring, was lucky enough to do it again, and had some very good discussions with the students. I think especially former Councilor LaTorre would be delighted with the pay that these students thought the counselors received. It was much closer to the pay he wanted us to receive than what we actually do. It was enlightening for all of us to go through that kind of discussion, as well as what the council does, and remembering that these are students who were last year's eighth graders and are quite politically aware. We had some good discussions about some of the events of last spring.
Good. Anyone else?
Councilor Amaro.
Yes, I came directly to this meeting from a meeting held at Wyndham Town Hall, which was sponsored by COG today, and the meeting is actually still ongoing. But the reason for today's meeting was to get together local elected officials with state representatives, state senators, and candidates for both of those positions to talk about legislative issues for the upcoming legislative session. Of course, property tax reform, as well as property tax relief, was probably the hottest issue, as well as a discussion of school funding and various proposals for how there could be some relief and reform of property taxes. So I'll be anxious to see what the final highlights are of that meeting, and I'm sure you'll be getting a report on it from the council.
Councilor Kerman.
Yes, Madam Chairman, I wanted to let people know that I had recently attended the public hearing on September 27th at 4 o'clock at the Cumberland County Courthouse of the County Board of Commissioners with regard to the proposed 1991 budget. This was presented to members of the Cumberland County Budget Advisory Committee, of which Councilor Jordan and myself serve on. On the one hand, we were delighted to see that the proposed percentage change in the increase in tax rate on the county level for 1991 looks like an overall 5.70% increase throughout the county, and actually for Cape Elizabeth there is a proposed 3.25% increase, which is just a little over $11,000 from last year's $340,000 figure. So although at this stage of the game this is not etched in granite, certainly a 5.7 overall increase when compared to the previous year of 34.92% is gratifying to see at least that we're in that ballpark. And hopefully in further meetings that we'll be having tomorrow night will be one where the Cumberland County Budget Advisory Committee will be meeting in an effort to pare down even further these tax increases. It looks pretty good for this year, but as Commissioner Hughes mentioned at the last public hearing, we will get hit very hard in 2 years when the bonding for the new jail is in process. We can expect a fairly significant increase at that time. So I think in the meantime, it's going to be very important to pare down as little increase as possible and to let people know there will be a second public hearing where all citizens are really invited. That's going to take place on December 10th at 5 o'clock p.m., again, at the Cumberland County Courthouse. And if there are throngs and multitudes attending, they'll move it to some larger area. But if you want a voice in the Cumberland County budget, please reserve that date at 5 o'clock. Thank you.
Mr. McGovern.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I have four brief matters to update the council on. The first is that I made you aware last Friday in your packet of a concern we have with a couple of holes that were found in the town's only ladder truck. In that memorandum to you, I indicated that the chief was going to be continuing receiving reports and having some testing done. Today, it was taken to a place that does ultrasonic testing of the metal in the ladder. And the result of that testing found that the ladder is, in fact, structurally safe, that the holes that were found were simply a weld joint that had gone bad, and the repairs were made this afternoon, and the ladder is back in service. So it was a close scare in terms of, you know, what can happen, and I think it, you know, served to remind all of us that that ladder is 40 years old. And, you know, even though we see metal that, you know, certainly lasts a long time, it is something that does need to be closely watched. And I think, you know, really reflects the need to continue on a capital improvement schedule and to seriously look at replacing that vital piece of equipment in 2 years when it's intended to be replaced. Second, a brief update on the depredation program. I've had a number of questions regarding it. As of this point, the harvest has been 7 deer as of earlier today. So far, we have not, in this office, received any complaints from citizens regarding any aspect of the project since it has begun. The police department is continuing to closely monitor the situation, and it has not proven to be once all the phone calls and all that was done, and other than the press relations, it has not proven to be too much of an impact on the police department. The third issue I'd like to mention is just confirming what has been published in the newspaper, and that is that we have secured the services of a new town planner who will serve as the town's first full-time municipal planner. The individual chosen is Maureen K. O'Meara. She comes to Cape Elizabeth having served most recently as a senior planner for the city of Portland. Earlier served as a planner for the city. Prior to that, was a planner for the Greater Portland Council of Governments. And earlier during her college work, she also served as an intern for then Congressman David Emery. I think Maureen, you know, brings to the town a good level of experience in the planning area, and I think will be a tremendous asset to the community, to the planning board, and to the other efforts that the town does in the planning area. I'd also be remiss if I didn't mention at this point that this also means that we will be losing the services of Steve Butler when Maureen starts on October 22nd. Steve has been our municipal planner for about 5 years now. I haven't checked to see the exact period of time, but during that period, he has overseen many site plan reviews for the planning board, working very closely with them. I think one of the major accomplishments he had was assisting the Comprehensive Planning Commission in their work as they recommended to you a new comprehensive plan. And Steve has done a tremendous amount for the town of Cape Elizabeth, and you know, I really think we owe him a great deal of thanks for his great service to the community. The final thing I want to mention is clarifying that the public is very much invited to a ceremony at Fort Williams this Saturday, October 13th, when the Maine Army National Guard is having a celebration where they're designated the 133rd Engineer Battalion is the 20th Maine, which is the old, much-decorated Civil War group from the state of Maine. They're also having a battalion change of command. There's going to be a Civil War reenactment group present, Company B of the 20th Maine Regiment, Maine Volunteers. The group is authentically uniformed with the uniforms of the 1862-1865 period. There's also going to be some displays of military equipment beginning at 11 a.m. The actual ceremony is at 1, and is expected to be around 500 members present of the Maine Army National Guard, and you know, probably with it'll be the greatest military presence at Fort Williams since it closed in the early 1960s, and you know, certainly ought to be an interesting celebration. So everyone is invited. And
I certainly hope we'll have cable coverage for that, for all those who can attend.
I haven't spoken to the cable folks to see if they're interested, but I will ask Lillian, our cable coordinator, if there is some interest.
If it's possible. Okay, I want to recognize the receipt of letters from Mr. and Mrs. McVicker in reference to the 1226 Shore Road residence, which was recently purchased by the town. And also, I have a letter from Maine Waste Management Agency, where I have to nominate members to a work group that will assist in finding a disposal area for ash from PERC and MERC. I need one elected official and one appointed official. They're going to meet three times in the late afternoon and evening during October 29th, November 13th, November 19th. And the Southern Group, Central and Eastern Southern Group, will meet the 30th, November 14th, and November 20th. So anyone interested in serving on this committee, please give me your names this evening if possible. I think it'll be an interesting experience for all. Is there any other correspondence? If not, we'll move on to the first item on our agenda, a public hearing for the proposed charter amendment change to increase the school board size from 5 to 7 members. We received a citizen's petition last month, and it has been set as a referendum question for the election in November. We also have received a letter from our town attorney certifying that it is indeed a legal document. Mr. McGovern, do you want to add anything? Is there anyone here present who wishes to speak on this matter? Would you please come forward and give us your name and address?
My name's Diane Joyce. I live at 2 Fenway. I'm the chairperson for the committee with a petition. I have three of my committee members out there. We came to the school, the town council in June and asked how to increase the school board. We were given two options. We chose to petition as citizens. August 13th, I think, we turned in our petition. We had 970 signatures. We needed 866, 20% of the last gubernatorial election. 907 were certified. So we made it. So I have a few notes I'd like to read. I want to thank everybody that helped us do it. Along the way, I've come up with a few questions that people presented us, you know, as we did the petition. And the big question was, are the people concerned to run? And yes, there are, and they'll be filtering out. I've had a few people call to see what step they go, and I've directed them and answered their questions. But my major question is, how much money is it going to cost us to add two people? I guess people don't realize that it's a volunteer position. And I explained that to them, and I don't feel it's going to cost us anything. I think in the long run it's going to help. It's going to ease the school board. There's only 5 members to add 2 more. The budget process, subcommittees, I think, is up to about 12 now. So it's going to ease the pressure to add 2 more into it, to work divided up, equal time along everybody, and not all the pressure on 5 people. So I think in the long run, we've been through a big process since June, since we asked the question, how do we do it? Now that we've done it, I think it's up to the people now to look what's gone on and to know that 5 people can only be a plus, not a negative. And I guess that's about all I have to say. I'm waiting for November and Anybody have any questions? No?
Is it unusual that Cape Elizabeth is the only one who's planning on increasing their school?
No. There's been three towns, Yarmouth, Gorham, Scarborough, and there's another one in process and doing it. Most towns do have seven-member board. Cape is one of the few left that don't. We're with five. And a lot of input I've gotten is I asked a lot of questions from a lot of people, and the input I got from the school board from a member was they didn't think that seven members would work because they have such a hard time getting five people to attend one meeting at the same time. And that was the only input that I got from anybody that I saw negative. And you guys are all seven board member, and you on subcommittees and committees, and you seem to do your job quite well and all work around each other and get it done. So I think coming in numbers of seven is a helpful hand to the public, to the schools, and everything that needs to be done. I can't see where it would hurt. It doesn't cost us any money, and more manpower, more hands to work, more minds to filter into the big year we have ahead of us.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Is there anyone else?
I'm Tim Thompson, and I would like to also speak in favor of this referendum. I think it, for a lot of the same reasons that were mentioned earlier, it just makes real good sense. It's going to get more minds working, more hands working, spread the task that seems to be burdensome now amongst more people. And again, I think Cape Elizabeth, for the school size, the school population size that we have, I think there's not any school district that has that being handled by five school board members. And I'm confident that there will be the strong people that, because this is another concern I've heard, are there going to be people that are going to be willing to run? And I can assure you that there are some very fine people lining up to run for those positions.
Thank you. Councilor Jordan?
No, I'm all set.
Okay. Is there anyone else? Okay. This was sort of a special opportunity that we wanted to give the citizens to make any comments on this item. It was not necessarily mandated that we have a public hearing on this issue. If there's no other comments, then we'll move on to our next item, which is item number 64, which was tabled from our last meeting, September 10th, 1990. I'd like a motion to take this item from the table.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor? Thank you. This is to consider a request from New England Telephone Company for an easement on a town-owned lot at the intersection of Columbus and Mitchell Roads and take any necessary action. New England Telephone representative Nancy Bosenhart is here with us. They have submitted their plan with a site plan with landscaping. Would you like to come forward and show the public what you have?
Yes, I'm Nancy Bosenhart here on behalf of New England Telephone Company. Thank you, Madam Chairman and members of the council. Also with me is Michael Delateschi, who is a representative of OST Associates. They're the folks who prepared this site plan, did the survey work, and also developed the landscaping plan. As briefly as I can, the issues that were raised as a concern, details which needed to be covered, which were not prepared and finalized as of the September meeting, include the easement deed and the site plan and a landscape plan. And all of those items are in your packet. The landscape plan is on the site plan. Michael will address those specific points and answer any questions, specific questions that you may have with regard to that. The one other point that I wanted to make is that Councilor Reed, I believe, raised the very good question of whether or not the cabinet would be the long side of the cabinet would be parallel to Columbus Road or could be placed in a perpendicular manner so that the narrow edge, the 18-inch edge, would be facing Columbus Road, and that might, and we agree, would be less of an item that you would be noticing. So visually, we agreed with your concept, and it can be done from an engineering perspective and, in fact, will be done on this site. Also, immediately following last month's council meeting, I met, as did a representative of OST Associates, with a neighbor, Mr. Etzel, who had expressed very politely to me some concerns about how the landscaping was going to be done, and we agreed that his input was important to us, as it always is, and we met at the site with him, and another neighbor came over, and both had their input into the development of the site plan, and their requests have been honored in the details of this plan. So we hope that the abutters feel as if we have fairly sought their input and have taken that into consideration and honored those requests. So if there are any questions regarding those points or any of the documents that were submitted to you. Madam Chairman, you gave me just prior to the meeting some revisions that you'd like to see made to the easement deed, and I've reviewed those, and we can make all of those changes.
Thank you. Councilor Reed.
Yes, Madam Chairman, I would like to affirm that I spoke with Mr. Etzel and Mrs. Lawton regarding the changes and their concerns being met, and they're very pleased with the telephone company's cooperation and listening, and that they asked me to vote for this.
Any other comments from councilors? No. Thank you, Ms. Rosenhart. Any discussion? Councilor McLaughlin.
I'm sorry, I had a question. I'll wake up here. What color is the cabinet to be?
The cabinet will be the same color as was in the picture in the...
There was a photo last month.
Yes, which is a brownish-green color.
The dark bronze.
That's right. Okay. It's intended, that color is intended to be a camouflage, have sort of a camouflage effect. Mm-hmm. And in fact, on that site, we feel that that particular color will blend well with the vegetation that's already on that end of the lot.
Right. Yeah. I want to commend New England Telephone for the materials you prepared for us this evening. You've answered all the questions that I think were brought up last month. You've done it in a timely manner. You've dealt with the neighbors. I think you've conducted this very well, and I do commend you for it.
Thank you very much. Appreciate it.
Councilor Jordan.
I'd like to have them explain the area more as far as bushes, trees, and what have you that's going to camouflage the cabinet.
You'd like him to go over the landscaping plan?
I'd like to ask Michael Delatetsky from OST to do that.
It was asked of us to put everything in there as evergreen. So three out of the four plants that are listed are evergreen with leaves. The other plant that's evergreen has needles. But and three out of the four plants also will flower. So there's pink, white, and pink, red flowering. In this area. The area around it is all hardwood. There are no fir trees out there or anything like that. So it didn't seem reasonable to put a lot of pine type growth in there. So we decided to put the things that were leafy. They also selected it to be put in there because they're good for the shady area that it is. And it's also an area that catches water. So it's good. All the growth there is selected because it also will grow well in a wet condition.
Thank you.
Any other questions? If not, I'll take a motion on this item.
Madam Chairman.
Councilor McLaughlin.
I'd like to move that we approve the boundaries of the 100-square-foot easement, the landscape plan, and the provision of sufficient safe site distance, with the edge of the easement being 50 feet from the right-of-way of Mitchell Road, and accept what is presented in our packets this evening, including the revisions to the easement language.
Second.
Any further discussion? Mr. McGovern.
Thank you.
I almost promoted you.
Not the first time. I think the council also ought to direct in its motion the amount that is to be compensated and where the proceeds are to go. Yeah, $4,000 was the discussed amount.
To go to where?
The land acquisition fund.
Wherever the council would like it.
I will amend the motion that the amount to be received by the town is $4,000 to go to the town's land acquisition fund.
Second on the amendment.
All those in favor of the amendment? All those in favor of the motion? Left hand, right hand. It's passed 7-0. Thank you very much for the extra effort you put into this project. Next on the agenda, a public hearing on the time period for filing variances. Mr. McGovern, would you like to give us some background on this, please?
I think this was before the ordinance committee. Did you want to handle it? You want me to?
It was somewhat before the ordinance committee. It's just minor. Would you like to do it, ordinance committee?
Yeah, we'll handle it. Madam Chairman, this has been reviewed by the Planning Board and I believe the Zoning Board of Appeals, as well as the Ordinance Committee. This language revision is to bring our ordinance into conformance with state law. What it does is say that if you receive a variance from the Ordinance Committee, you must file it now within 90 days rather than previously 30 days. So it's giving an extension to the time of filing of a variance at the Registry of Deeds.
Any members of the public who wish to make a comment on this item? There being none, I'll close the public hearing and we'll move on to item number 77. To consider a proposed ordinance amendment changing the time period for filing of variances approved by the Zoning Board of Appeals and take any necessary action. Is there a motion on this, please?
Madam Chairman.
Councilor McLaughlin.
I move that we accept the proposed ordinance amendment changing the time period from 30 to 90 days for filing of variances approved by the Zoning Board of Appeals.
Second.
Any further discussion? All in favor? 7-0. Public hearing on the Keeper's Quarters Financing Program. Mr. McGovern, would you give us background on that, please?
Yes, I'd be happy to. Last month, I approached the town council at the suggestion of the Portland Headlight Keeper's Quarters Building Committee regarding the possibility of utilizing proceeds that are to be received from admission fees and other income from the Portland Headlight Keeper's Quarters Museum in using those funds for the purpose of having a bond that would pay for some of the upfront cost in developing the museum. It was a long sentence. Specifically, at the suggestion of the committee, I did take a look at it, and through some conservative assumptions, saw that the estimated revenue from the museum could be approximately $91,000 per year. The projected expenditures would be $41,000 a year, leaving a net profit of $50,000. I checked with one of our primary financing sources and asked them if we had income coming in of $50,000 a year, how much could we borrow so that over a 10-year period we could have a cash flow that would support a bond. They responded that we could support a bond with those assumptions of $335,000. My specific proposal to the council last month was that the town float a 10-year bond of $285,000 and that those funds be utilized for exterior restoration, for the building renovations, including some museum development cost, as well as for the development of a gift shop to go into the garage on the Portland Headlight property. I want to make clear in this that if the town obligates this bond, while my assumptions indicate it would come from Portland Headlight proceeds, that in approving the bond, you would clearly be also providing that if for any reason that fell short, that the town would make up the difference. While, you know, I have had conservative assumptions, one never knows, what could happen, and I think it's only fair that be stated publicly that you know, that the town is guaranteeing its full faith and credit should the proceeds not come in. The council has before it tonight a draft motion authorizing the borrowing that was prepared by our town bond council, as well as a draft motion that would establish a Portland Headlight Fund. And this particular fund is the fund that not only all the expenses and revenues will be kept track of for Portland Headlight, but also it would be tied into the fundraising that's going to need to occur for the development of the actual museum itself. I'd be happy to answer any questions members of the public have, as well as the council at the appropriate time.
Is there anyone from the public who would like to step forward and make a comment on this proposal? There being none, I'll close this part of the public hearing, and we'll go on to council discussion of this bonding. Comments? Councilor Freeman.
Mr. Manager, with respect to the actual timing where profits will be coming in based on the expenditures that would be allocated for the upcoming 1991 fiscal year, what will the net increase to taxes be for 1991?
The intent is to have it zero. The bond would be established in such a manner that during the first year to year and a half, we'd be paying interest only on the bond. The still hoped for date opening the museum is August. And if this weekend's activity with all the foliage buses are any indication, you know, I do think that we'd get a reasonable amount of our business in there in August, September, October. Furthermore, you'd have the spring of the next fiscal year. So, you know, I don't envision during the first year any problem meeting the interest cost for the bond, which would be approximately $11,000 for the first payment for the 6 months and $11,000 for the second, actually a little bit less than that.
And are we assuming that the rental of the keeper's quarters will coincide with the opening of the museum?
For financial planning purposes, yes. In actuality, the apartment may be ready before the museum.
And we could actually begin a rental system prior to August 7th, if that indeed is the day of dedication?
Yes. Yeah. It's also possible the gift shop may be ready before that, because that is expected to be a profitable venture. We'll get much profit from it.
Council McLaughlin.
I know this is to Mr. McGovern. I know that you're making some conservative estimates here. You had for the expenditures for maintenance and utilities, I'm assuming that includes the heating.
Yes, it does.
Do you think this figure is still in the ballpark with all the recent increases in heating costs?
I think the building maintenance utility expense is still a little bit on the high side. We were shocked when we found out from the Coast Guard how little they pay to heat that building. And I think with the insulation that's now going on the outside walls as part of that work, I don't see a major increase in the cost. And, you know, they were less than $2,000 a season for heat for that building, even out on that exposed point.
For the entire building?
For the entire building. It was a little surprising.
Okay, I did see them. I was over there today and did see the tie that they're putting on the insulation. Thank you.
Other questions, councilors? Councilor Jordan.
One question. In the Portland Headlight Fund vote, it speaks of down there of the clothing without limitations, cost, operation, maintenance, and repairs of the keeper's quarters. Now, which comes first, paying off the bond or the maintenance and the repairs? Do we separate this to start with, or do we wait until you take in your money and then pay? Which one first?
Obviously, I don't know. I think this is a chicken and an egg story, Councilor Jordan. That we have to. I think we really have to meet all the expenses. You know, we can't leave the place unheated, and we've got to pay off the bond. So, you know, my sense is they're all going to have to come at the same time. You know, we can't default on the bonds, nor can we not maintain the building.
Excuse me. I'll admit that you've got to heat the place. You've got to keep the place open and all this and that. But the way I read this, some changes could be made, and maybe that would be decided to do that instead of eating and what have you and coming back to the town for some money to pay the bond.
Yeah. You know, until you established a separate board or a separate committee to oversee Portland Headlight, you know, the specific budgeting approval for use of any funds for Portland Headlight remains with the council. So, you know, at this point, you know, unless you set up some sort of a board, it would be the council operating the museum and totally operating this fund. You would have those decisions through the regular budgeting process.
So as of now, the decisions come back to the council?
Yes, unless the council sets up another mechanism at some point. You know, it's possible you may want to have a separate advisory board or a board with more than just advisory authority, but that would be a council decision.
Thank you.
From the quiet end of the panel. Perhaps Michael Lee should also stress the fact that we're not authorizing a bond of such a small amount, that this is really part of a much larger bond, so we can take advantage of better interests.
That's correct, right. Madam Chairman. The council has previously authorized a $422,500 bond for school improvements, which have been taking place, and we were funded out of our general fund awaiting this bond. There's this bond. There's a $100,000 towards the Jones property, approximately $100,000, and there's still to come. You're going to be receiving cost estimates between now and the end of the year, or just after the first of the year, on the renovations and improvements to the public works facility, and it will all be incorporated into one bond to reduce the borrowing cost, and paying fees, agent fees, and all those things one runs into when one borrows money.
If there are no further comments, I'd like a motion on this item, please.
Madam Chairman, I would move that we authorize our town manager to negotiate and or float a $285,000 bond and 10-year financing for improvements to the Portland Headlight Keeper's Quarters, and in addition to establish a Portland Headlight Fund as set forth in the three-page document provided to us by our legal counsel as indicated by item 78.
Is there a second?
Second.
Further discussion? Does that motion satisfy all the needs?
I assume the intent was to include the full draft from the bond council as part of the approval.
All three-page document.
Any further comments? If not, all those in favor? 7-0, the motion carries. The next item is the public hearing on the BOCA and 1 and 2 family dwelling code, which I believe the chairman of the council will present. Chairman of the ordinance committee will present.
Elevating people to all sorts of high places.
Why not? You have to be ambitious.
That's why I'm over here.
Oh, come on. Uh-oh.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. Get our act together. As I think the council is aware, and hopefully the public is aware, the ordinance committee has been working on Chapter 6 of the ordinances, which is the construction codes. And the main intent of this was to update our ordinance to incorporate the 1990 BOCA National Building Code. And one thing I'll just share with you that I learned, I talk about BOCA at times in my professional capacity, but I finally figured out what it meant. It's the Building Officials and Code Administrators, which was a nice revelation to me and certainly makes sense. Some of the major items in this update are that for each violation of the construction code, there are new financial penalties. The minimum is now $25, proposed to be $25 rather than $10, and the maximum $1,000 rather than $100. Other revisions are making the BOCA the Boca Code specific to Cape Elizabeth, therefore putting it into the language of our ordinance rather than keeping some of the generic language in the Boca Code. And those are the major changes.
Is there anyone who wishes to step forward and make a comment on this particular item? Do we have any staff people who wish to make a comment on this as it's been drafted? There being no further comments, I'll close this part of the public hearing, and we can now have council discussion. If there's no discussion, then I will take a motion on this item.
I'll move for the adoption of the 1995 Prevention Code and the Boca Code.
Can't do that.
We're just doing the Boca right now. Boca.
Oh, you're just on the book. I read the wrong one. I'm sorry. I'll move to consider the proposed amendments for the construction code adopting the 1990 Boca Code and the 1986 one and two family dwelling code.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any further discussion? All those in favor? 7-0, the motion carries. The next public hearing is on the Fire Prevention Code, and to consider the adoption of this Fire Prevention Code. Once again, we'll go to Ordinance Chairman Janet McLaughlin to give us some background.
We're saying how delighted we are. We've gotten something done in the Ordinance Committee. Sometimes wonder.
Very good.
Them having been bogged down in the wetlands for so long last year. What we are doing, presenting to the council in this item, is consideration of adopting revisions to Chapter 8 in our ordinance, which is the Fire Protection and Prevention Code, and this will update that chapter and bring it into line with the 1990 Boca National Fire Prevention Code. Now I can return these books and don't have to carry them around anymore either, which is another plus. Changes in the Fire Prevention Code. One significant change which developers may encounter is that fire lanes shall now have a minimum, of 18. The language there is still not quite good. I don't know how the lane. Anyway, to increase the width of the fire lane from 16 to 18 feet. And other changes, again, are just making it specific to Cape Elizabeth rather than some of the generic language in the Boca Fire Code.
Anyone from the public who wishes to make a comment on this particular change? Anyone from staff who wishes to make a comment other than their previous recommendations? There being none, I'll close the public part of the hearing and we'll go on to council discussion.
Madam Chair, I was just going to mention to the Ordinance Committee that maybe fire lanes shall maintain a minimum width of 18 feet. Would that work?
I think if we say fire lanes shall be.
Shall be.
Shall be. That's it.
Councilor Crowman.
I have a question for the Fire Chief, Madam Chairman.
I believe Chief Webster is present.
Chief, if at some point in the future a development takes place in Cape Elizabeth that has emergency access to it only, would those roads, let's just say they were two hammerhead type roads that were connected by a strip and locked gates of some sort, would those roads also have to comply with the minimum of the 18 feet?
Yes, they would, and they'd also have to be maintained year-round.
Okay.
That's one of our big problems, is keeping these emergency access plowed and et cetera year-round.
Mm-hmm.
But we would pretty much require the 18 feet.
Okay, thank you very much, Chief.
Any other questions? Councilor Amaral.
Madam Chair, I would move adoption of the 1995 Prevention Code as presented.
Second?
Second.
Any further discussion? All in favor? 7-0.
Mm-hmm.
Next item is public hearing on possible unsafe structure at 130 Ocean House Road. Mr. McGovern will give us some background on this, please.
Yeah, last month I made the council aware that we had a concern that 130 Ocean House Road may be unsafe and suggested to you that I wanted to get underway the process for actually finding this as an unsafe structure. We have tried to work with the building owner since then and haven't really had much luck. I know the fire chief had some conversations with him about possibly using it as a training exercise, and there just hasn't been any follow-through on the part of the individual involved. Consequently, last week I asked the town attorney to begin actually incurring expense, which entailed the actual drafting of an order and a notice of a hearing for the council to review. As you notice, or maybe it's not specifically in the notice, but it's in the state law, we have to serve them with a deputy sheriff, and you know, you begin to really incur some costs. So anyway, what the town attorney's done is actually prepared for your consideration a notice of a hearing, and it suggested that there be a hearing, and it be on Wednesday, November 14th, 1990. The draft that the attorney came up with says November 12th, but November 11th is a Sunday, which is a holiday, meaning that the legal holiday will be on Monday the 12th, and the council meeting would be on Wednesday the 14th in November. But the code enforcement officer, as well as the fire chief, is here, should you have any questions this evening on this issue, or should members of the public.
Any comments from members of the public on this item? I would like to ask the code enforcement officer to come forward and tell us his concerns.
Madam Chairman, we met with Mr. Pori, and I met with Mr. Pori and his architect. And the cost to save that building apparently was more than they were willing to put into the building. And we required that they give us an engineer's report plus an engineer's review through the whole process to ensure that the building's integrity was there and that the corrective measures were done properly. They elected not to do that, to go that far. What they did do is they came back, took all the windows out, left the building open. The rear foundation is partially collapsed, and that's the purpose for the order that's before you tonight, or the request.
Questions from any of the counselors? Thank you, Mr. McBain. I'll close this public part of the hearing, and we'll go on to consider item number 81, authorizing notice to be served. Who would like to make the motion? Councilor Pearson.
Madam Chairman, I would like to move that we proceed as indicated by the town attorney to find the structure at 130 Ocean House Road as an unsafe structure and schedule a public hearing. Is that correct? For that purpose?
November 14th.
For November 14th at 7:30 in the council chambers.
Your second. Any further discussion? All those in favor? Public hearing on November 14th. Item number 82, to consider a report from the Ordinance Committee regarding a proposed sign ordinance and take any necessary action. Councilor McLaughlin.
Thank you. You've been busy.
Well, I don't agree with it at all.
Well, neither do I.
If you don't mind, let's get on with the presentation, please. I'm going to have to separate you two.
No, we do an Ordinance Committee meeting right here.
We're very efficient. All right. We have before the council this evening a draft. I want to emphasize that it's a draft of a proposed sign ordinance, basically. This would be a new chapter in the Code of Ordinances, Chapter 21. What we decided to do was to bring this to the council, hopefully be able to have it be set for public hearing next month so that we can obtain citizen input, where at a point where we feel it's going to serve everybody's best interest if we have citizen input at this point, rather than try to say we have a final draft and want that to go to public hearing. We do want to hear from people in the community who have signs, because this will have a direct impact on those people. We also want to hear from people in the community who look at all the signs that are around here, because this will also have an impact on all of you who look at the signs in the town. What we have tried to do is come up with some language that presents what the signs, what acceptable signs might be in the town. This is to replace existing language that's in various parts of the ordinance, but at this point, there's not language in every zone description for permitted uses, and we think that needs to be corrected. That's one reason that we have been working on a sign ordinance. It's been very difficult for our planning board and for our zoning board to make decisions regarding signs, because there is not specific criteria and standards for them to base their decisions on. What we're hoping to develop is an improved regulatory vehicle for those boards to use in making their deliberations. Some of the proposals in this draft would be that no roof signs are allowed. This would mean that a sign that is, with the current definition proposed, a sign that is on or above the roof line of a building would not be allowed. I'll get specific and say I know there are at least two of those signs I can identify, one being down, is it Tim's, of Two Lights now, and there's one sign on the at the Pond Cove Shopping Center that extends above the roof line. With the language that's being presented right now, those two signs would not be conforming. Another kind of sign that would not be conforming would be a sign that is lit internally, and we do have a number of those in town that I will not enumerate. The language says that only that signs may only be lit from an external or an outside source, so it's signs with the neon tubes or whatever in them would not be allowed under this draft language. It's been discussed at length in the ordinance committee, and I would hope there would be discussion at the public hearing about the nonconformance of existing signs. There are a number of ways that the eventual language could go on this. One alternate would be to say that signs that are not in conformance would have to come into conformance within a certain set period. One suggestion for that set period would be a five-year period. So if you had a roof sign, say, and the ordinance went through saying roof signs were not allowed, that sign could be required to be removed within 5 years if you put in that kind of non-conforming language. Another alternate to consider is saying that all signs existing at the time of approval of the ordinance are grandfathered until any changes are made in them. That means that they would be acceptable as non-conforming signs until you made a change in them, if you want to increase the size or other change in them. And that's something that I hope we will have some good input on. Other things in the ordinance, right as it's proposed at this point, are criteria for the height of the sign and for the size of the face of the sign where the message is. There are also established criteria for gas stations and shopping center signs. Before we do anything more with this, I would like to bring to the council's attention two changes that should be made in what you have before you tonight. On page 3, subsection E, talking about garage sale signs, in the second line it says, and not more than 1-3 off-premises signs. That should be corrected to read, not more than 3 off-premise signs. And on page 5, there is a chart giving the height and such of signs. For freestanding permanent ground signs, on the column to the far right where it's maximum number allowed, that should be filled in with the number 1 for that type of sign. One question that the ordinance committee had posed to the town manager was in reference to political signs. He did photocopy state law for us. This says that signs bearing political messages relating to an election, a primary, or a referendum may not be placed within the right-of-way of a road prior to 6 weeks before the election, primary, or referendum, and must be removed no later than 1 week thereafter. Our question was whether or not a political sign on somebody's lawn within their property line, not in the right-of-way, could be erected for a longer time, and apparently it could be, and not violate state law. Thank you.
Any comments from councilors? Councilor Jordan.
I want just one comment, and I'm hoping that people will filter some information back to the ordinance committee, because we have been going around and around on this sign ordinance quite a lot, and there's some areas there that I don't think all three of us disagree on, especially the one on the five-year conforming, and also the one as far as which we didn't add into this because we didn't know just whether we should or just how to go about it, is these signs that soda machines lit and what have you, how are they considered as a sign? And this is going to be quite a project time you get, and I think that is could be considered a sign if it's lit up and it's internally lit. And there's one other one as far as I would like to see someday that we could put in. We have taken these areas in the town and dug up the asphalt and put grass down on these intersections, and there've been flowers put there. I would hope that we can have an ordinance or something so they don't get plastered with political signs. And I think it would be covered as a right-of-way type area. I know other areas or other communities, they load them up, and I just hope this is, I was reading it and I was wondering if it was covered sufficiently, that's all.
I believe that the ordinance committee did have that discussion about not allowing that in the future, and that's town-owned property.
On page three.
On page three, nope. Right. Section C. I thought we felt had addressed that. No political sign should be placed on the pavement of a public roadway or bikeway, on traffic islands, nor on town-owned property, except signs authorized by the town clerk of Cape Elizabeth to indicate the date, time, and place of polling. So I guess we sort of thought that maybe that would, so we wouldn't have a bristling island like we did a few years ago, the only grass-covered island in town at that point. There was someone from the public who wanted to make a comment. If you please come up to the microphone, give us your name and address.
Hi, my name is Tony, and we're on the House of Pizza down here, mm-hmm. The Cape House of Pizza. I'm wondering, you know, I do like to put a little sign on the window. And I approached, a few months ago, I approached Ernie, you know, the inspector, I think it is, the gentleman over there. And he told me that I already used my space for a sign, okay? So I only got one sign on top, on the face of the building saying House of Pizza. So what I want to do is I want to put a little sign on the window saying for my specials. And I think that when I understood it, maybe I took it wrong, that he said that I can't use any signs on my windows because people on the Cape, they like to not see no signs coming home at night. Is it right, sir? Or I'm wrong? That's what he told me. So now what I'm asking you guys is this. Can I have some kind of a sign to put on the window or to put on the lawn for my specials? That's what I'm asking for. I'm asking nothing much. And that's, I think is...
But we, of course, at this point, can't give you authority to do...
No, I don't want it right now.
Yes or no. I mean, Mr. McVeigh has to deal with the present ordinance, which we said is very inadequate, ambiguous.
Yeah, but excuse me, you know, CVS, IGA, Dunk Store has all the signs in our windows. Nobody bothers them. The Coke machine is out there on the sidewalk all night long. The Pepsi machine and the Coke machine is there all night long. And, you know, it's nobody bothering them. But why me?
Well, there's still some debate as to whether or not those really are signs. But, Mr. McGovern.
In this draft, Tony, there's two specific provisions which would address your concern. One is if it was a permanent window display, and a permit for that could be issued by the codes officer, and it could cover 25% of the total glass storefront, and you could have one of those. If you were looking for a temporary window display, much as, you know, you'd see in a grocery store that puts up its ads, you can put up any number of temporary window displays are allowed without a permit, provided not more than 25% of the total glass storefront is covered, and provided the signs are removed within 30 days of placement. You know, that you change them every 30 days, and that you could do without a permit. That's the right now. It's, you know, it's not allowed, and this particular ordinance would clarify that type of thing would be allowed.
Thank you very much.
Okay. Anyone else from the public?
My name is Tom Tinsman. I live at 24 Ocean Avenue, and I also own ERA Tom Tinsman Associates. I've had a chance to look this over quickly. I think it's an excellent idea. There's obviously a lot of work that's gone into this. I think addressing the political signs is my biggest problem in the town. I think those things are terrible, and I'm glad to see you doing something about those. I would like to just address one area, and I think that and that's on the existing signs that are now in the ordinance. I personally think it's a good idea that there is going to be some type of an ordinance for signs. I think that it is needed before things get out of hand. I don't personally think things have gotten out of hand in this town. I think we have an attractive Main Street, and I think things are fairly attractive. I haven't look through this totally to see if there's an addressing the temporary letter types of signs. I personally am against those. I have a permanent letter sign in front of my office, which I'm a little bit biased for. And with that in mind, I would like to see the alternate under section 21.5.2 to take the alternative D, which would be any permanent sign not conforming with the standards of this ordinance at the time of its enactment may continue until such time that any change is made to that sign. And the reason I believe that this is the way to go is that I really don't think that we have a problem in this town with the signs that we have. There are existing signs right now that are backlit signs that I think are attractive. I don't think they're out of character with the town. I think at some point, if we allowed them everywhere, I think they could be a distraction. But I personally, driving through town, and I've lived here over 33 years or so, I don't think that don't think we have a problem with that at this time. So that would be what I would favor.
Thank you.
Madam Chairman, I'd like to ask
Councilor
Tom
Jordan.
Tinsman, I'd like to ask you a question, and that was brought up at the Ordinance Committee. A sign like that you have in front of your business there, would be your opinion of putting a candle power allowed in this ordinance by toning your sign down as far as how it lights and glares?
Yeah, that would be fine. You know, I
you
think
you wouldn't hesitate in something like that.
No, not at all. You know, that was the type of sign that was recommended to me by the sign people, and it was pretty much a standard type of sign. I don't have any problem turning the, you know, if that would tone it down a little bit, that'd be fine. I was a little bit turned off with my own sign when I first saw it go up with how bright it was. My brother built a new house about 2 miles down the road, and I could see it from there. So, you know, as far as that goes, I think they could use a little toning down. And I don't have any problem with that.
What's your feeling of having them shut off at 11 or 12 o'clock at night?
No problem. I think that's
a good
idea.
That's no problem with you?
No.
There's a couple of the things that were brought up in the ordinance.
Yeah, I think that's a good idea. You know,
Thank you.
The idea behind having them lit is so that people can see them during normal hours, and I think after 11 o'clock is certainly reasonable.
Thank you.
Mr. McVain, would you want to make any comments as to the necessity or lack of necessity of a sign ordinance, or do you feel things were pretty well expressed?
I think the matter has been covered accurately. The only thing I'd like to add is that we have a great deal of difficulty with the shopping center. The ordinance is geared up for individual lots, and when you deal with several businesses on a certain parcel of land, there's no good method of applying these standards. Do you apply them to the building? Do you apply them to the whole parcel? So it's difficult, and we do need to revise it.
Do you feel that what's being proposed is going to be helpful or meet your
needs? I think
needs,
we've come a long ways, yes.
But you still think that perhaps there could be more?
A little refinement
there and
there, but I don't see any major changes. No, just a few items. One being garage sales. We need to address that.
Okay. Thank you very much. Any other comments?
Maybe we should have him write some comments and send them to the ordinance committee.
That would be helpful.
And we would review them.
Mr. Tanza.
Yes, can I make one other point?
Sure.
I did notice in here that the for sale signs for homes would, under this ordinance, not be able to be more than 6 square feet. Can I get back to you guys? I'm not sure how big my signs are. The ERA signs are, they're long, and, you know, I don't know if they're 6 square feet or 7 or 8 or just what they are.
I don't even think they're
4.5.
We seem to think that was a generous, that it was larger than most signs. But why don't you measure yours and get back to us?
Okay. Thanks.
There being no comments. Oh, Councilor Reed, I'm sorry.
Oh, I have several.
Oh, good.
The first section I'd like to ask about is section 2152, section A, regarding line 3, may be removed by the code enforcement officer. I was just wondering... Should that say be ordered removed, or should Mr. McVain or his successor actually remove it himself?
If you'd like, reading on that sentence, what it provides is that it may be removed by the code enforcement officer anytime after an attempt has been made to notify the apparent owner to remove any such sign immediately. You know, someone could put up a sign. I hate to use a specific example, say there was a restaurant down on the Sprague property and someone put a sign up. You can't find someone, you know, the sign's inappropriate. My sense is he ought to have the authority to remove that sign and to put it in safekeeping, later return to the owner. The problem is if he doesn't have that authority, you know, there's no way of moving the sign.
Okay, I didn't know if maybe I just missed a word or if that was clearly the intent, and after it's been explained to me, I understand it. Thank you. The other thing, I strongly support Alternative D, and I've talked with several people, including people who sell signs for a living, and the suggestion is that some of the signs we have in Cape Elizabeth to replace would cost between $3,000 and $5,000, those signs which would not be in compliance with this. The other comment I would like to make about the signs like Mr. Tinsman's property and also the town's fire department sign, that has an impact on the community other than just lighting as far as the messages being sent about, you know, soccer champions and things of that nature. And I think as a general rule, the population would understand if maybe it weren't as aesthetic as some of the other nice wooden signs. But that, I had asked several people that I ran into. I had made the comment before in workshop that I ran around Cape Elizabeth trying to find all the signs that were offensive to my eye, and I only came up with two. And I'm sure they'll be replaced pretty soon. My other comment was on page 3, number E, regarding the garage sale sign, and I was interested in Mr. McVane's comment, because I don't know what he would do with it, but one of the things that I thought about was placing the signs only 2 hours before an event. I didn't know if that could be 24 hours before the event and remove 2 hours after the event was over, just as a way of advertising, you know, that something was going to start at 8 in the morning if they put the signs up on Friday afternoon, if that would be acceptable. Those are the end of my comments. Thank you.
Okay. Any other comments from councilors? I do have one suggestion. I know it was sort of briefly mentioned in one of the workshops or ordinance committee meeting, was an alternative D for sort of grandfathering non-conforming signs. At one point, the discussion did suggest that in addition to having any change of the sign made, that's when it would have to become conforming, or it also would need to become conforming if there's any transfer of ownership of the business or the property. I can give you that to think about, but that was mentioned before. Mr. McGovern.
I had one other point. Councilor Jordan brought up the issue of traffic islands and signage. This ordinance does specifically prohibit political signs on them, but one thing we saw this weekend is someone put a huge garage sale sign, you know, on one of the traffic islands that, you know, I think that type of thing would be unfortunate if there was a proliferation of that. I tried calling MDOT yesterday and didn't find the people in who could answer the question as to whether or not they have specific regulations, because I noticed in the state statute that the commissioner is authorized to promulgate regulations for signs on state property, and I don't know if the state specifically prohibits traffic islands, but I would think that the council, you know, may want to prohibit all signs on those islands except for the town-erected traffic directional signs, because they do serve to inhibit visibility where there are a lot of turning movements. I'll check with the state, too, to see if it's already covered by the state law.
If not,
I have a citizen that can.
Is there another? Is there a citizen who can answer that question? Would you? Would Mr. Chase? I believe you're an employee of the Maine Department of Transportation.
One of the other hats I wear is traffic operations for the Department of Transportation. Quite familiar with sign laws, and one thing I might be able to help you with is, basically, as far as the Department of Transportation is concerned, most everything within the urban limits of Cape Elizabeth rests with you people. We do have general laws that cover the state in general. And any sign that's in a traffic island or an intersection that interferes with highway official signs, whether they be town or state signs, they can be eliminated. Or on a traffic island, especially if they interfere with visibility of traffic flow or interfere with the visibility of people reading official town or state signs, they also can be removed. That exists today, any intersection. You probably really don't need to address that. It's probably pretty much covered, although I will remind you again that within the urban limits, the power is pretty much with the town. Outside of the urban limits, like the strip down here belongs to the state, we enforce the right-of-way. And within right-of-way limits, there's no off-premises signing allowed. Now, the sale sign, of course, is allowed, but any other signs, like if some restaurant or some business wished to stick a sign up there, that wouldn't be allowed under state law presently. We have a special act for that, Travel Services Act, which Cape Elizabeth does not allow these signs anyway under an existing ordinance. I regulate that business in Southern Maine.
Thank you. I'm glad you were here.
You're welcome.
Madam Chairman, that brings up a good point that I didn't hit on, really, that a lot of these for sale signs are set up on these traffic islands to head the people in that direction. And I think it's something that we really should think about.
Okay, thank you. I'll take a motion on this item, please.
Madam Chairman, I would move that we set this proposed draft of Chapter 21 sign ordinance to public hearing at the November 14th, 1990 Town Council meeting in Council Chambers at 7:30 p.m.
To a second. Any further discussion? All in favor? 7-0 for public hearing at our November meeting.
Is Tony looking for your attention?
Item number 84, to consider a report from the Ordinance Committee regarding dead-end street standards and take any necessary action. Would Ordinance Committee Chairman Councilor McLaughlin give us background on this, please?
Thank you, Madam Chairman. The Ordinance Committee has been working on ordinance language to revise the existing language regarding dead-end streets. We've had input from the Planning Board on this. We've had written input and have had a Planning Board member attend one of our meetings. We've had written input from the town department heads, the fire department, the police department, and public works department, and from one developer who has a number of subdivisions, in town. At this point, we feel that the current language is a balance of the concerns presented by those department heads and planning board members, the developer, and the counselors on the ordinance committee. What we would like to see done is to have this set to public hearing next month. If there are still outstanding concerns, the Ordinance Committee is very willing to take this back, work on those concerns, and bring it back for a second public hearing if necessary. Within the Ordinance Committee, we do not have consensus on all of the items presented in this draft, so we're hoping that public hearing will have some good discussion for all of the counselors and for the public. I think I'll just read the proposed language at this point. This is a fairly short one. This is to revise Section 16-3-2, sub A, sub 9 of the subdivision ordinance, dead end streets. Dead end streets shall be no longer than 1,000 feet in length unless the Planning Board determines that a greater length is necessitated by the unique layout characteristics of the land or by the specific site conditions, including but not limited to wetlands, surface water bodies, rock outcroppings, designated scenic areas, or significant tree stands, and that the greater length will not impair traffic safety or emergency vehicle access. Dead-end streets longer than 500 feet shall have underground utilities. Dead-end streets longer than 1,000 feet shall service no more than 20 dwelling units. A dead-end street shall be measured between the points where only one means of access exists. Thank you.
Comments from any counselors? I guess I was not present at a couple of the ordinance committees that when you last dealt with this, so I guess my concerns are, since we had a letter from our planner dealing with comments from the fire chief, police chief, and the director of public works, why some of these have not been incorporated into this proposed draft. They did submit a proposal designating how these dead-end streets should end with a cul-de-sac or beginning point of a T-shaped turnaround. And I guess I really think that hopefully the public will come and make more comments. Is it true that it was proposed that an esplanade effect can be used before you start measuring your dead-end street?
We decided to not make any reference to an esplanade effect.
it was our feeling that that kind of road configuration did not have an impact on the one-way applicability when measuring. That even if it's an esplanade, it would be a one-way, it would be considered, I'm sorry, a dead end for the length of the esplanade if that was between the two access points.
I think that should be clearly stated, though, just for interpretive purposes. I know we have our professional staff. Some of them are present. Is there anyone who would want to make a comment on this current proposal, which is being set for public hearing, or do you want to reserve your comments for the public hearing? Mr. McGovern, do you have any comments on this particular item?
I was unable to attend the last meeting of the Ordinance Committee since I was out of town at the time. But, you know, I do very much appreciate the attention and the consideration that the Ordinance Committee has given to the views of the department heads. And in particular, the provisions that they've included in the current draft, providing that on longer dead ends that shall be served by underground utilities, and clarifying better how dead ends are to be measured. You know, I was pleased to hear this evening that the Ordinance Committee would not consider a split esplanade as any different from another road, although I'm a little bit concerned that the draft doesn't reflect that, you know, that perhaps that ought to be clarified. I in discussing this with the department heads at a department head meeting this morning, as well as prior to this, they still have some fairly strong reservations about the current draft. And, you know, while I think the department heads and I appreciate the attempt by the Ordinance Committee to balance the concerns of the department heads with the concerns that were expressed by the Planning Board, we remain concerned that public safety may be compromised. We can, you know, see the day, and we have seen the days when we have certain dead ends in this community and certain events happen, and everyone asks, well, why haven't you done anything to resolve the particular issue on the existing street, or you know, that type of thing, let alone, you know, whether or not we ought to be allowing this in the future. And I cited an example at an earlier meeting to do with Cranbrook, where back during Hurricane Gloria, I think it was, I witnessed a fire truck attempting to get down to Cranbrook in an area with less than 20 homes, longer than 1,000 feet, and the fire truck got trapped in there and couldn't get out by fallen limbs. And you know, that remains, you know, a very recent, vivid memory. Similarly, on Hannaford Cove Road, just a few months ago, two or three fir trees by Henry Berry's came down right across the road, and Hannaford Cove was inaccessible for 2 or 3 hours. You know, as much as we would like to think that these events don't happen, they do happen. And, you know, I think we're someday, you know, particularly I think of Columbus Road, I think of Broad Cove, Shore Acres, Hannaford Cove, you know, it's a disaster waiting to happen. And I think when the council is looking at this and has an opportunity to review its standards, it ought to give the utmost concern to public safety. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Councilor Jordan.
Just to make a comment of what you spoke about on some of these roads. But those roads originally were planned to go through to another one, and since then the planning board has had somebody along the lines of different ideas, and they don't want to tie them together because the public don't want them that way. So what do you do?
You know, I think what I'm saying is I realize those public concerns are there. However, public concerns tend to change once they see a particular disaster or event occurring. And, you know, I think the municipal officers have an obligation to be foresighted and, you know, to try to represent community views as much as possible, but also to work with the public and the community in understanding long-range public safety implications. And, you know, my feeling in this is that you should more tie the hands of the planning board than this current ordinance draft does in order to fully ensure that we don't build future Broad Coves and even areas to a much lesser extent along dead ends that have the potential for serious public safety consequences.
Well, I kind of agree with what you're saying there as far as a Broad Cove and what have you, but the planning board and as far as Columbus Road, I'll take Columbus Road for an example, because I remember very vividly that was to be tied to Ocean House Road when that was planned and developed. Since then, the meeting of the minds have changed because they don't want to go through a grove of trees there that it's in line. So who is at fault with what you're saying? The people that allowed it first with the idea of it going through are the ones that come in and put the roadblock up at the end?
I don't think it's appropriate to point fingers and to say who's at fault. I know we've been dealing with that issues with some other recent events in town quite a bit, but I think when those incidents happen, we ought to learn from them and look to the future. And I really see this ordinance review as a chance to look to the future and to avoid those types of things happening. And when you're looking at developments, you don't allow them from the very beginning to get into that situation. If it is of a certain length, you just simply don't allow it to be of a certain length with so many homes, beyond what is reasonable. I think this is a chance to not let those situations happen again, and to make a clear policy direction from the council.
I think could possibly be the beginning of a very exciting public hearing next month, and perhaps
I think it could continue
some of that discussion then.
I can think of three places that has been tried for the last 10 or 15 years to get through roads, and they get either a house or a garage or something built in its way, and the neighborhood comes up and they don't want through roads. So I think if that's what we're going to do, we should either put them in and not listen to them, or not allow the development to start in the first place.
Councilor Creelman.
Without wanting to continue this debate any further on into the evening, I just want to make a couple of comments, because this paragraph has probably a similar volatility as does the current sewer ordinance. It's made up of basically five separate thoughts, and certainly the thought of should dead-end streets be greater than or less than 1,000 feet in length, it is probably going to be the sticky wicket on this particular ordinance. What we tried to do was to, on the one hand, not be arbitrary, because when you're arbitrary and you attach a magical number to something like a 9.9% increase in the budget, the press calls it 10% anyway. So we didn't want to do that. What we wanted to do was make a statement, and I think the only way we're going to be able to get this to public hearing was that so few people showed up at that particular meeting, because otherwise we could wrangle over this issue forever and ever. So my hope, because there was not majority on this particular paragraph, is that we will have a lively public debate, and we will debate in the public forum the issues of public safety and the topographical aspects of a particular new development. That's basically the bottom line, and that's why we want to get it out as soon as we can to a public hearing and not keep coming up with another new particular exception to the rule. We end up going nowhere that way.
Any other comments? If not, I'll take a motion on this item. Councilor Jordan.
I'll move that we set this revision of section 16-3-2 of the subdivision ordinance regarding dead-end streets to a public hearing on November the 14th at 7:30 p.m. at the town hall.
Second. It's been a second. Any further discussion? All those in favor? 7-0. Item number 84, to consider a request for a zoning ordinance amendment relating to health fitness facilities in a BA zone and take any necessary action. Mr. McGovern, would you please give us background on this?
Yeah, Mr. Thomas Tinsman has utilized the zoning amendment process of the zoning ordinance to request an amendment to the zoning ordinance providing that health fitness facilities be allowed in the business zone in the community, I think specifically the VA zone. He has paid the requisite fee for the consideration of this, and the ordinance procedure does provide that once that fee is paid, that the town council shall refer it to the planning board for their review and consideration. Looking at his specific proposal, you know, I think that there's a policy issue, you know, that certainly will be debated on whether or not you want to allow these things in a VA zone. And the one weakness I see in it is that health fitness facilities do need to be defined within the ordinance. And certainly Mr. Tinsman, you know, presents very well in his letter his reasons for wanting to allow them. But, you know, I think for the long-term protection of the community, obviously you do need a definition for those facilities. He is here should the council have any questions.
Mr. Tinsman, would you like to come forward and just give us background, or would you prefer to just have us ask questions?
Thank you for the opportunity. This, there is quite a bit of background that went into the thought of a health fitness facility, and I agree with the town manager that there does have to be a definition of the usage of a facility like this. Unfortunately, the ordinance as it is now written does not address this at all, and I have been coaching youth basketball and Little League baseball and soccer here for a number of years, and I've been employed by community services for these functions right along. And one thing that I've become very acutely aware of is that the facilities in this town are very deficient. And I don't want to make it sound like we don't have facilities that could be used for these purposes, but in just looking at the gym space that we have right now, the community services, who I'm quite close to and work with, have expressed a strong interest in having more space made available to them. I know that some of their programs now have to go out of town. A lot of their programs are closed because of lack of facilities. So I would like to implement a building that would alleviate some of these problems and have some facilities for these uses. In addition to that, I think a health fitness center of the type that would allow for family usage for wellness and fitness types of needs by having some workout machines, cardiovascular machines, an instructor who can teach wellness, these types of things also are needed by the townspeople. I've had a lot of discussions with people in the town who are members of facilities like these that have to go into either Portland or Scarborough or some other towns, and it's quite difficult for people to fit into their schedules to be able to go to these facilities. And there are a lot of people that don't join these facilities because they're not available within their schedule to be able to go to them. So I think it is something that would improve the quality of life in Cape Elizabeth. I think it's something that is needed now for facilities, and it's something that I would like to start a planning process on once we can come up with an addressment of what a health fitness facility actually would entail.
Questions from any councilors? Councilor Reed.
Thank you. Madam Chairman, for Mr. Tinsman, what would the hours of operations be primarily, and how many days a week are you planning to operate?
Well, that's something that would have to come from some planning in the future. I'm not really certain exactly what it would be. It would depend on the demand for the facilities. I can visualize a facility that would be open 7 days a week because I think there is a demand for that. I was talking with Sue Weatherby with Community Services today, and she mentioned to me that right at this current time, the existing gyms in this town are filled to capacity on the weekends, and they have to shut off the usage to people who would like to use them further. There just isn't anything available to them.
Your fifth and sixth grade basketball program today had to be abbreviated?
Yes. Yes, and when I coach fifth and sixth grade basketball in the wintertime, we're not able to practice hardly at all. We go into game situations playing against other schools who have use of their facilities, and we're really pretty much at a disadvantage. We just don't have the facilities to be able to use.
So you're not coming in here with any definitive 7 days a week, 24 hours a day in mind? You're open to whatever?
I would think it would depend on the demand. And right now I know that community services starts at the schools with some of their programs at 6 o'clock in the morning. I know my wife has gone to aerobics at that early hour, and I've heard that the swimming pool is open even earlier than that. And that's the type of thing where you have to fit the people's schedule. There are people who go to work very, very early in the morning and come home late at night, and they don't have time during the day. And it is the type of facility that I would like to make it available to as many Cape Elizabeth people as possible. And one thing that I have thought a lot about is that the scale of the development would be scaled to serving just Cape Elizabeth. It is certainly never going to be a facility that I would envision going beyond the capabilities of serving Cape Elizabeth people. It would not be designed to draw people from South Portland or Scarborough. Not that we don't want them using it, it's just that I don't think our physical capacities would allow us to do that, and that's not my desire.
Are there other questions? That's all very interesting, I think, but basically what we have to decide tonight is your request that the use in a BA zone be expanded to include a health facility. There is that ability in a business B zone presently, is that right?
No. Athletic and recreational facilities are now allowed in a BB zone.
Right, in the business B.
Right. And there would be some similarities to this.
Right. So I think that's what we basically have to decide, and you would have to go through site plan, planning board, and if this were approved. What we also should consider, and I'd like to recommend as a council, is if we decide to pass this on to the planning board to consider, that we also ask them to consider other pressures that are being put upon the business zone. We've already been asked to alter the street setbacks in business zones. We have no real definition or lots as they're addressed for business land. We have no density requirements as to how much land can be covered by building facilities, parking lots. So I think this should be something that should be considered too, as well as if anything is on sewer, how that sewer accessibility would determine its approval, as well as definition. So I think that probably this is a good beginning for us all to even start looking at the new business zones in general.
Mm-hmm. I also noticed in the Cape Cod, I wasn't part of these meetings, but I noticed that there is a movement towards reducing the setbacks in the business zone currently. Currently, I think it's 100 feet, and I know that they're reducing that. So I know there is and also in the comprehensive plan, there is an encouragement to focus business uses in the current business zones. And currently, there is only one BB zone that I know of, and that's only where the Inn by the Sea is, and that's currently up to maximum capacities. I mean, maybe you could tell me better than I know, I don't know, but there are only currently three BA zones in the town that I'm aware of. One currently in the center of town, one by Tim's of Two Lights, and the other one is on Shore Road where the cookie jar and the filling station is down there. So it's not as if this is the type of thing that's going to proliferate throughout the town. And even if it did, each project would have to stand on its own merit based on the current zoning, the setbacks, the density uses, and all those things which would go through the screening process of the zoning, planning, and appropriate boards. So primarily what I'm looking for is just to allow this in a BA zone, and then let each individual project, as they come up, have to go through the appropriate processes.
They would have to anyway. Any other comments? Councilor Jordan.
I would just like to say that I liked your letter, and I think it's an excellent idea, and I just hope we can move forward for it, because I think there's a lot of people in the town that use these type of facilities. There'll be an area there for old people, I take it, when you get it completed.
It'd be a spot for everybody.
Over 90 or under 90 or something?
Everybody.
Councilor McLaughlin. Thank you, Madam Chairman. Madam Chairman, I appreciate the points that you were bringing up, and I think it's worthwhile to pass those along to the planning board if we do send this to them. My one exception would be the setbacks, which has already been reviewed by the planning board, is due to be reviewed, I believe, by the zoning board later this month, and then by the ordinance committee later this month. So I think that has been, is in process to be looked at. Just so Tom will know what the a potential time frame is for this. I did talk to the current planner and tried to get a potential schedule, which could be that this could go to public hearing with the planning board in December, come back to the council, and then be set to council public hearing, come back to the council in January to be set to public hearing in February. So just so you know how long it takes to do something like this. I'm sure you know how long it takes to do a lot of things, but just so people have a reference from which to work, I think it's helpful.
Yeah, you had it sooner than I did. I thought if he got it to the planning board, get done with it in 3 months, that we'd be.
Mr. George. Okay, so that at least we know that's the optimistic time frame for this particular thing. How does the council feel on this item? Do you want to make a motion or you want to continue your discussion?
Madam Chair.
Councilor Amaro.
I would move that we send this item to the planning board, and with the additional request that they look into the business zones in general and the specific areas that you mentioned earlier.
Second it.
Further discussion? All those in favor to sending this to the planning board? 7-0. It's begun.
Thank you.
Item number 85, to consider a report from the Appointments Committee regarding vacancies in the School Space Study Committee and take any necessary action. Councilor Amaro.
Yes, once again, we were very fortunate to have several people show an interest in serving on the School Space Study Committee. And I'm very pleased to recommend to the council that Ed Capano and Ann Chapman be the town council appointees to this committee.
Second motion.
Any further discussion? Okay, and then as town council chairman, I too had some appointments to this committee. We needed a representative from the town council, and I'm very pleased to announce that Councilor Carl Pearson has volunteered to be a participant in this committee, and that also in conjunction with Chairman Leslie of the school board, we have appointed Jeff White as the chairman of this school space study committee. So I think there again we have a sterling committee, and I would move that we accept those appointments as well.
Second.
I have a question, Madam Chairman. Do you know who the school board appointment is from the school board?
Nancy Sanger and Joyce Freeman.
Right. I thought a school board member was going
to be. A school board member.
It's Charlie Greer.
It's Charles Greer.
Thank you.
Right.
Now, which motion are we voting on here? Councilor Amrose or?
I thought we already voted on hers.
I didn't.
We will
maybe
vote on
the rest
Councilor
did, but
Amrose's motion first. All those in favor? And now the chair's appointees, all those in favor? Thank you very much.
What? I think she does.
Do we? I'm sorry? She what?
She was whispering messages to me.
Yes.
She's going to get more.
It's warm in here. Item number 86. To consider two renewal leases for the portable classrooms and take any necessary action. Mr. McGovern.
Yeah, last month you approved the lease for the new portable. These are the leases for the prior portables, and they were authorized by the school board to be signed by the prior superintendent, and he has signed them. It's now before you to authorize me to sign them on behalf of the community. They are the standard lease provisions with the standard amount granted by the State Department of Education for the square foot basis, which is $8 per square foot.
So you want a motion to authorize the manager to sign these portable classroom lease agreement?
Second.
Sound good?
All those in favor?
Madam Chairman, I have a question.
Oh, all right.
Excuse me.
Your hand was just there.
It was just there, right. I'm wondering if the planning board or zoning board put a limit on the length of time for these portables.
Yes, they did.
And what is that?
5 years.
So what year are they in with this extension?
The portable between the lunch school and the elementary school is in the third year. The portable behind the middle school, what I call the IA wing, I don't know what they call it, second year.
Thank you.
Any other comments on these leases? All those in favor of authorizing the manager? 7-0.
Just if I may, I'm a little bit out of order, but there's been a lot of questions about walkways and that type of thing with the new portable, and there's complaints about mud, the kids walking and having to walk around the outside of the new one, and that work will be done out of the funds for the third portable, even though it wasn't specifically part of the planning board site plan. We are going to be doing some paving over near that portable, in case you should have questions on it. Thank you for your patience.
You're welcome, Mr. McGovern. Number 87, to consider approving the warrants for the 1990 general election and the 1990 municipal charter amendment election and take any necessary action. Would Town Clerk Derby Pizzo please give us some background?
Thank you. The Town Council has it before it this evening, the warrant for both the general election and a special municipal election to be held Tuesday, November 6th. The election will be held at the Cape Elizabeth High School Gymnasium. The polls open at 7 a.m. and they close at 8 p.m. I'd also like to announce that the absentee ballots are available. Anyone who will not be present on November 6th to vote in person, you may obtain a ballot through the town clerk's office by either coming in and voting here at town office, or give us a phone call and we'll make arrangements for an absentee ballot by mail. Thank you.
I would move approval of the warrants as so described.
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor? 7-0. Item number 88, to consider a request for an abatement of taxes from the Greater Portland Realty Trust and take any necessary action. Mr. McGovern?
This actually should be the Greater Cumberland Realty Trust, and this is a request for an abatement by the Inn by the Sea. I spoke to the town attorney today to confirm whether or not he had spoken to the attorney for the Inn by the Sea to inform him that, yes, in fact, this would be on the agenda. There had been some preliminary discussion of it, and you know that it would be. Tom Leahy, the town attorney, called the attorney for the Greater Cumberland Realty Trust, and he was not fully aware that it was going to be on the agenda, and he wanted a chance to review the town attorney's opinion, advising the council that it is not in order for the council to grant the abatement. And the town attorney suggested that he would recommend to the council, and that I would convey it, that it was his suggestion that it be tabled until your November meeting, at which point the attorney representing the Greater Cumberland Realty Trust would have had a full opportunity to review the opinion of the town attorney regarding this issue.
Councilor McLaughlin.
I'm very concerned about this issue. I'm wondering what kind of effect it has on the lien process if this is tabled for a month.
The lien on the Inn by the Sea, or on this property which constitutes the Inn by the Sea, is due to mature in February. It has no effect on the lien process other than the fact that at one point the attorney for the Greater Cumberland Realty Trust indicated that we couldn't expect too much in the way of taxes for this particular fiscal year, the older year, until the issue was resolved. But, you know, they did indicate they were going to be paying some taxes for the fiscal 90 year, and they did pay some, but we await the balance of what they agreed to forward to us.
We're being asked to extend a professional courtesy to this, to the lawyer representing the applicant. I'm very distressed that the applicant has not extended financial courtesy to the town. They're on record as saying that they pay their taxes in August and September. That has not happened. I contacted David Ledoux at the State Bureau of Taxation about this. I did read what we had in the packet from the state statutes and have read what our own town attorney has presented us with his findings of fact and previous written correspondence from him. It's very clear to me that this town council has no statutory authority to deal with this issue. We cannot grant the kind of abatement that is being requested. There is a one-year window to make that kind of request. That window has passed. Tabling this for a month is not going to make one bit of difference.
Technically not, but it, I think, is a personal and professional courtesy, especially since it was requested by our town attorney that we should extend it. But I do question the other attorneys not really knowing this was going to be on our agenda, simply because when the renewal for the liquor license came up, we told him that this item would be coming up on our agenda in October. So I think we can still abide by our attorneys. We can, if you so wish, recommendation, or we can just decide to act on this tonight. Councilor Creelman.
Well, I echo Councilor McLaughlin's sentiments too, but in an effort to avoid lawsuits, I mean, I think we can table the issue for a month, and I so move that we table the issue until the November meeting.
Second motion.
Further discussion? There being none, all those in favor? None. Opposed? 6-1. Table for next month. Item number 89, to consider establishing a process for the review of the potential uses of 1226 Shore Road and take any necessary action. Mr. McGovern, will please give us some background on this?
Yes, at a workshop the town council had late last month, they asked the staff to prepare a draft for a new committee that would study potential uses of 1226 Shore Road, which is also known as the Jones property. In response to that request, I did prepare a draft.